Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Terry Fox, and I want to thank you for watching with us on our online ministry. We're going to be studying the Bible today and studying some very interesting topics. This is Holy Week, and this is kind of a very special week across the world for Christians, not only for us here in America, but across the world. And, you know, with the pandemic going on and everything has changed, and as some people have said, there's never been another Easter like this one. And you know, that's probably true when you think about it. I can't imagine any time in history when people couldn't come to church and actually meet together and serve together. But yet the church still celebrates Easter. Let me tell you, I've said it many times that the devil and the demons, they could not hold back the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the true Easter story. Well, let me tell you something, neither can a virus. If the devil can't do it, a virus can't do it. And those two may be tied together, by the way. But we know as Christians that we have a lot to celebrate. We celebrate every Sunday. You know, every Sunday is a celebration. In fact, any day of the week. Some people say, well, Sunday is the Lord's Day. But the truth is, and those of us that are saved know this to be true, that really every day is the Lord's Day. So I want to thank you for watching our online ministry here at Summit Church Texas. We're easy to get to. If you would like to preview some of our other sermons, our other pastors have been preaching. We are continuing to do a message every single night at 7 o'clock Central Time. And we've been able to do this now going on 3 weeks. And so we want to welcome you to go to summitchurchtexas.com/media. There you can go back, or you can go to Summit Church Texas Facebook, and you'll find a lot of sermons there from different pastors. We have a large pastoral staff here at Summit Church Texas, and there's a lot of great sermons out there. A lady that I won't mention her name, well, I'll mention her first name, she had said to me, her name was Amy, and she said, I've been saving all of your sermons, and I'm going to bring my family over when this all calms down, and we're going to study and we're going to listen to all those sermons that you've been preaching. Well, that was kind of encouraging to me, because we love to hear from you. We want you to chat with us. We want you to be involved. We're not here together, meeting together, but because of the media ministry, we're able to be connected together. And we just love it. Each night when the pastors are preaching, we love for you to chat with us. We love for you to comment something that jumps out of the message to you, or God has spoken to you. We want you to share that. Be sure and message it to us. If you have any questions about what we're teaching on, we received a note from someone that had several questions, and so we're going to be answering those questions as we study the Word of God, not only today, but again as we study the Word of God together every single day. I want to do a shout out again to Telling the Truth Ministry in Wichita, Kansas. I love you guys. We love doing our monthly rallies there in Wichita. We're going to be adding weekly Bible studies in Wichita, Kansas. I know that there's a lot of changes going on in Wichita. I know some of you are looking for a new church. Some of you are looking for a place to invest your life. Well, I want to encourage you to pray about working with us at Telling the Truth Ministries. We are going to be doing some amazing things. Our goal is to impact Wichita. We're going to be winning souls. We're going to be discipling people. We're putting together care teams. We're going to be ministering to people in Wichita. And so don't get discouraged up there. If you're looking for a new place to serve, you're looking for a ministry that you say, man, I want to be a part of, I want to be involved with, then Telling the Truth Ministry could be that place for you in Wichita. Also in Arkansas, we're doing great ministry there. The home base of Telling the Truth Ministry is out of Greenwood, Arkansas, in my hometown. And so I am so thankful to the people in Arkansas and Kansas. And especially, I want to say thank you for giving online. Not only are the people here in Corpus, and I hope that all of the members of Summit Church Texas, I hope all of you guys are giving online right now. If not, you need to be mailing your check in. Nancy told me today that she had received quite a few checks in the mail. So I want to thank you for remembering your church here. Even though we can't be together and we don't take an offering in the traditional way, we need you to be faithful in your giving. I'll tell you this, we are reaching at least 1,000 people a day with our media ministry. On a slow day, we have 1,000 people. Sometimes on Sundays now, we'll have over 3,000 people that are being a part of this ministry by watching the messages of our pastors. And so all of you that are members of Summit Church Texas, this is a time to be faithful. Even though we're not meeting together, be faithful with your giving. Go online. It's easy to do it. SummitChurchTexas.com/give. SummitChurchTexas.com/give. And if you need any help with doing that, just send a message to us, and either Rose or Tyler or one of us will get back with you and help you understand how to give online. But I do want to take a moment to say thank you. Thank you to the people in Arkansas that have been given. I noticed many of you are giving online. And Wichita, Kansas, many of you are giving to this ministry. You say, well, why should we give to this ministry? Why should we give to the online ministry here in Corpus Christi? It's because God is using it in your life. I love to tell people, if you're being fed by a ministry, then you need to support that ministry. So I want to encourage you to give. Maybe give something sacrificially. We could sure use it at this particular time. We're helping people with food. I've been in 3 different homes this week carrying food and helping some of our older people, and then just some people that we just want to reach out and love on. I just love our church here in Corpus, and I love the people that come to this church. So I want you to know that we're more active as a church than we've ever been, and I think that the world is seeing that. I understand the governor in Kansas has decided to personally attack churches. I watched her press conference, and she took on churches a little bit. And here's just another liberal Democrat. You know, I've said many times, the Democrats continue to vote in people like her in Kansas. What a terrible governor she is in Kansas. But I got news for the governor of Kansas. I got news for anybody else out there, all the Satanists. I know the Satanists are really excited because they think the church is going to go away now because we can't meet together. Man, I mean, how foolish is that? What they don't realize is the church is more energized than ever. So whether there's a governor or a prime minister or a king or even a president someday that decides that they're going to stop the church or kill the ministry of the church, let me tell you something, they're only wishing. It'll never, never happen. The only thing that's going to remove the church from this earth is the Lord Jesus himself. When the groom comes for the bride, the Bible says that the body of Christ is the bride of Christ. And when the Lord decides it's time to come in the rapture, he's going to call us to meet him in the air. And then the church will be gone. And then the Antichrist is coming on. And then the unholy trinity, the false prophet, the Antichrist, Satan himself is going to take over the world for a season. And then, of course, we're going to come back with Jesus someday in the second coming. And we're going to cast Satan and all the demons. First of all, we're going to judge them. And then we're going to cast Satan and all the demons into the lake of fire, the book of Revelation talks about. But the church is not going to go away. In fact, I believe that persecution that we're seeing now at the church, when you have a sitting governor in Kansas taking on the pastors in Kansas, and her real heart comes out in that interview. If she could, she would close the churches all the time. And by the way, for you Catholics that are watching out there, my understanding, she is a Catholic. And that ought to really bless your heart. How in the world she's able to continue to give communion and be for killing babies and being pro-choice is besides anything I can imagine. I can't wrap my mind around why the Catholic Church would allow that, especially someone of her influence. Well, this is Holy Week, and you say, well, there's persecution in our world today, and I've been talking about it a little bit, but let me tell you something. There was persecution during the first week that Jesus went to the cross. We call it Holy Week, and every day there's a special day set aside where we look at a different aspect of Holy Week. It starts with Palm Sunday, and Palm Sunday is when we know when Jesus made his entry into Jerusalem. He rode the donkey. I love to tell people that there was a time that Jesus came riding in on a donkey, and they would put the palm leaves down. Well, I want to tell you this. That is a true story. Jesus did come riding in on a donkey. But I'm going to tell you, the Bible says the next time he comes, he's coming on a white horse. The donkey represented humility. And the reason that Palm Sunday was important, it was that Jesus was saying to them, I'm going to humble myself, and I'm going to get ready to go to the cross. Well, we're doing a special study today. And what I want us to zero in on today, there were several events that led up, starting with Palm Sunday, and then we call it Holy Week because there were several events that kind of occurred, and they were all predicted by the Bible, by the way. Everything that's celebrated in Holy Week is all taught in the Scripture. Some of it's taught from the Jewish point of view. The Old Testament, Scriptures talked about Holy Week, and they prophesied about the coming of Jesus Christ. So we started with Palm Sunday and Jesus coming in, riding that donkey, being humble. Then we see of all the trials, and all the trials that Jesus went through were unfair. And we know that they eventually put Jesus into the courtroom, and they convicted him. And by the way, all of that was illegal. Everything that they did with Jesus, I'm talking about the legal system of that day, was violated. They broke all the rules. And they hated Jesus so much, they couldn't wait to get Jesus on that cross. And not only did they hate Jesus, but they hated his disciples. They hated his followers. Let me tell you, the Bible tells us that nothing's changed. The Bible tells us, as we get ready to start thinking now about Friday, and we call it Good Friday, and we've celebrated Good Friday. And then, of course, we're really going to celebrate on Sunday, because Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. And so as all these events were leading up to the cross, and people were persecuting Jesus, they were crying out, crucify him, crucify him. They wanted Jesus to go away, and they wanted to kill Jesus. And, of course, we know that when Jesus died on the cross, and when Jesus was ascended to going back to heaven, he ascended back with his Father, he went back to heaven. We know that history tells us that all of those disciples were persecuted. Most of them were even killed. Some of them were crucified upside down, just to make a mockery of the way Jesus died on the cross. But I can tell you this: they may have killed their physical bodies, but they did not kill the true disciples of Jesus. And the Bible tells us that we're going to see all of them in heaven someday. In fact, the Bible tells us that in heaven there's five different crowns that are going to be handed out in heaven. You may not realize that. You say, Pastor, you mean it's possible to win and to gain five different crowns to be worn in heaven? That's absolutely true. One of those crowns was a crown of the martyr. That's the martyr crown was the crown that was given for men and women who died for the cause of Jesus Christ. I mean, think about how many missionaries have been executed. I think about Felix Muntz was drowned. He was a great Anabaptist. If you study history, you study about Felix Muntz. And the story has it, and it was recorded, that he was taken out in a boat, and his hands were tied. And they said to him, you must deny Jesus Christ, or we're going to throw you out of this boat into the water, and you will drown today. Well, they took him out about 100 yards, the recording tells us, and the papers wrote about it, the people talked about it, about 100 yards out. But on the shoreline, there were people watching this, and that's what would happen when Christians were being put to death. When Nero was killing Christians with the lions and the tigers, remember, people would come and fill up these great big coliseums, and they would cheer as the animals would destroy these Christians. And the same was true with the great Anabaptists. And as they were being killed for their faith, people would come out to watch the execution. Well, this is a true story. Felix Muntz's mother was one of those standing on the shoreline. And just as they made an offer to this man to say, if you will deny Christ, we will let you live. If you do not deny Christ, we're going to drown you today. And out of all those voices could be heard was his mother's voice. Think about that. His mother's voice. And she cried out, Felix, be brave, son. Be brave, son. Jesus died for you. Now you get to die for him. And the story has it that he was cast into the water, and he gave his life that day for the cause of Christ. Just think, when we get to heaven, folks, we're going to be around people like that. Then they're going to receive a special crown. It's called the martyr's crown, which means they sacrificed everything. Well, when you think about how awesome that is, and to me, that's pretty awesome to think that someone would give their life for Christ. I know it's happened here in America in a couple of the school shootings that Christians were chosen to be executed. I know the story of a young teenage girl. You might remember this. I think it was Columbine, but it was one of the shootings. And they said to her, are you a Jesus follower? And had the gun pointed at her head, and she says, yes, I am. And they shot and killed her instantly. And that young lady, I'm telling you, will be honored when we get to heaven someday. And I think about Felix Muntz, and I think about the great martyrs, and even the disciples and apostles have given their life for the cause of Christ. But I want us to talk about on this Good Friday. And people say, well, you know, what are you calling this teaching time? Well, what I'm really saying today is this is not fake news. No fake news here. And let me tell you something. A lot of fake news out there, and with the media, they're just a mob out there, and they're always telling things that are not true, or they put things in the wrong context. Media has always been a master at doing that. And so we've coined the phrase fake news, which means false news. It means that it's not the truth. Well, I want to tell you, there's no fake news in the Word of God. And as we study together and we think about this Holy Week, and we especially emphasize Good Friday. Good Friday is the emphasis upon the time that Jesus died on the cross. And there are a lot of scriptures that I could point us to today, but I want us to look at this scripture together. If you have your phone there, be sure and use your Bible app and look up this scripture. And if you're watching me or listening, you have your hard copy of your Bible, I encourage you to get it. I want you to turn to the Gospel of John, the Gospel of John. And we're going to be looking at a picture here, and really the Bible's pretty clear about what happened to Jesus as he was dying on that cross. I mean, it's pretty amazing, and there's been a lot of studies about that. And I mean, because just think about it, every word that Jesus said, I believe, was important. Have you ever noticed that in most Bibles that the words of Jesus are marked in red? And the reason they do that is because they're more special. I mean, all the Bible is the Word of God. The Holy Spirit guided everyone who wrote the Bible. All 66 books is a part of the canonized scripture. We call it canonized, which means it went through a tremendous process before it became actual scripture. And so that's how we know, and that's why we can trust all the Bible. All 66 books of the Bible can be trusted. We're going to be doing some study about that later. And I want to share with you several reasons that you can have trust in your Bible when you read the Bible. Some say, well, the Bible contains the words of God. No. It's much stronger than that. The Bible doesn't just contain the Word of God. The Bible is the Word of God. Boy, that's so important, and we'll teach, do some teaching on that. But the bottom line is, you can trust your Bible today. And the Bible tells us what happened on the first Good Friday. And when I say that there's no fake news, if the Bible tells us, we know it's true. This is true news. And not only is it true news, but the gospel is what? You've said it many times. You've heard it said many times. It is the good news. And it is good news. And it's good news because of what it produces for us. As we look in our scriptures here in John chapter 19, it gives the story of the cross, and it talks about all the events that led up to the crucifixion of Jesus. By the way, by the time Jesus got to the cross, by the time that he got ready to die on the cross, most people say that the people that knew Jesus, they had seen Jesus, they had eaten with Jesus, they had walked with Jesus, they had talked with Jesus, they could not probably even recognize his body that was on the cross. I want you to think about that. He had suffered to that point. I mean, they had mocked him, they had beat him, they had tortured him, they had whipped him. Remember the crown of thorns. I have a crown of thorns I keep in my office, and it's a crown. And remember, they put that crown on Jesus to mock him, King of the Jews. And so they put a crown, but it wasn't a crown like a beauty crown would wear, or a princess would wear, or a king would wear, but it was literally a crown of thorns. And in my office, this crown of thorns I have, the thorns are about 2 inches long. And I mean, they are so painful. In fact, when I move that crown of thorns, I have to be careful because I've cut myself on it many times just reaching in to move it. And they placed that crown of thorns on the head of Jesus. And they mocked him, and they laughed at him, and they said, if you are truly the Son of God, then bring yourself down. If you're the King of the Jews, then come off that cross. And not only did they beat him and physically beat him, his body was just torn apart, literally. I mean, the flesh, they beat every part of the flesh on the body of Jesus. They wanted him to suffer as much as he could. And by the way, that's what the cross was all about. The cross was all about suffering. The only people who died on the cross were the worst of the worst. I mean, today in America, we have the death penalty, and we have executions. I traveled to McAllister, Oklahoma, and to watch an execution. The person who was being executed, his family asked me to come and be there with them. And Pastor Pat Bullock and I traveled to McAllister, Oklahoma, and we were there. And that was a horrible thing to see, to watch somebody being put to death, and to be able to have eyes on that, and to be in the room that looked over the execution, and to wait for the governor to call to say that the execution would continue. That was a terrible thing. And as terrible as that was to watch, I can only imagine what it must have been like when Jesus was dying on the cross. All right, I want us to look here in the scriptures, and here in chapter 19, we're in the Gospel of John. After this, Jesus, knowing that all these things were now accomplished. I love this. I'm reading out of the King James Version. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished. We're going to talk about that in just a second. That the scripture, remember I said the Bible can be trusted? No fake news in the scripture. That the scripture might be fulfilled, says, I thirst. Jesus cried out, I thirst. And then we see in verse 29, he says, now there was a vessel filled of vinegar. They used vinegar, and that was what they did in that day. And they put it on the sponge and vinegar, and they put it upon the hyssop, and they put it to his mouth. And we can only imagine what Jesus' body must have looked like at this time. But Jesus now is entering the time when he's suffering's about over with. And I love it says again back in verse 28, don't miss that. Jesus, knowing that all things were accomplished. We're going to come back to that. All things were accomplished, okay? And then verse 30. If you're just tuning in, I want to welcome you. I want to encourage you to chat with us. We're talking about no fake news. We're emphasizing the cross. We're emphasizing why we celebrate on Good Friday. And the reason we celebrate was the sacrifice that Jesus made on that cross. And he says that everything that had led up to the cross had been accomplished. And then verse 30, this is a key verse. Those of you that have studied with me through the years, I always encourage you to put a star by your favorite verse. Verse 30 says, when Jesus, therefore, had received the vinegar, he said, now notice, it is finished. He says, it is finished, and he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Now, let me just say a couple things about that. I want us to keep your Bibles open there. We're going to talk about it. And it says that Jesus said, it is finished. I want you to see that phrase, tetelestai. Tetelestai is a Greek word, and it's a very common word. People knew what it meant in those Bible times. He says, and it literally means it is finished. That's one of the things that we celebrate about Good Friday, was that Jesus accomplished what he needed to accomplish on the cross. People say, well, why we call it Good Friday? Well, it's good for us because it provided a way for us to go to heaven. But it was more than just that. It's called Good Friday because Jesus had accomplished everything. I mean, he had accomplished it all. Notice that it says, and he says, it is finished. I want you to see those are the very last words that Jesus spoke on the cross. And by the way, don't you think it's kind of important? I mean, at that very point in time, and I believe that Jesus cried it out too, let me tell you. I don't think he just mumbled it. I think when Jesus was on that cross and he knew that he had accomplished everything that had been set before him, I'm telling you something, he cried out, it is finished. And by the way, I want to tell you this. Jesus was a man's man. You say, Pastor, what do you mean by that? I'm going to tell you, sometimes people think, well, Christians are weak and Christians are pushovers. Well, let me tell you something. Jesus Christ was not weak, and he was not a pushover. The fact he could carry that cross, the way he carried that cross after being beaten like he was. I want to tell you something. I don't believe there's ever been a man that was any more built stronger than Jesus Christ. I mean, there was nothing weak about his body. And I believe that when he cried it out, tetelestai, what a powerful word. It means it is finished. I believe when he cried out, tetelestai, tetelestai, I'm going to tell you something. I believe that the whole earth shook. In fact, I know it did. The Bible tells us that literally everything shook around them. Let me tell you something. You say, why in the world did the earth shake like that when Jesus cried out, it is finished? I'm going to tell you why. Because the whole world knew that something happened. Jesus dying on the cross was a really big deal because it had accomplished. You go back up to the scriptures again, and we see here, it says, now that things were accomplished. Now they were accomplished. That meant that Jesus had fulfilled his task. I think it's interesting, too, when you see that word tetelestai there. And when you think about the very last words that Jesus cried out, it is finished. You know, I thought about that, the words, it is finished. You know, let's think about the opposite of that. The reason we call it Good Friday is because Jesus accomplished so much on the cross. He became our sin for us. Literally, the Bible teaches us that not only were our sins laid upon Jesus, and they were as believers, Jesus paid for our sins, but the Bible teaches that he literally became our sin to the point that Jesus became sin that even his Father in heaven could not look upon him. I want you to think about that. Sin is a serious thing. We'll teach on that later. You know, today we live in a world where everybody sins and we justify sin today. We have new names for sin today. But I'm going to tell you something, my friend. Sin is a serious thing. In fact, it was your sin and my sin that put Jesus on the cross. Another thing I want to clear up. Sometimes I'll hear somebody say, the soldiers, those evil men killed Jesus. I'm going to tell you something. That's not true. Men did not kill Jesus. No man had the power to kill Jesus. You say, well, I thought Jesus died on the cross. He did, but he willingly died on the cross. They didn't kill Jesus on the cross. Listen to this. Very important. Jesus gave himself to us on the cross. You see, it was us that deserved to be on the cross. And we're going to talk about that in just a moment. I want to say just a couple of things here, and I hope you're studying with us. I'd like for you to comment. Tell me what it means to you. Do you understand if you're out there and you're watching me, and I know that hundreds of you are, perhaps thousands of you are, and again, we welcome you from wherever you're watching. You're coming. We're teaching and preaching today from the media ministry here in Corpus Christi, Texas, and we welcome you. I want to ask you this question. Do you understand that? Do you realize that it was us that should have been on the cross? Jesus was our substitute. Jesus stepped in where Terry Fox needed to die on the cross. Terry Fox was a sinner. Jesus was not a sinner. In fact, he was the perfect Lamb of God. Think about that. You see, what's interesting about Jesus was he was all man. That was human flesh that was up on that cross. But the interesting thing is that not only was Jesus all man, but he was all God. That's why we celebrate the God-man. You say, what's that mean, Pastor? It means this, that when he came through the virgin birth of Mary and God became flesh and dwelt among us, the Bible says that he became flesh. He was born of Mary. He was born like a human. He became a human. He was all human. But what is interesting is that not only was Jesus all human, but he was also all God. That's why the whole world shook when he said it's finished. And I mean the sun went out, and I mean the earth got dark, and I mean the world shook. And there's a lot of things I could teach about the theology of that. What it did, it opened up the access between man and God. We call it the priesthood of the believer. The priesthood of the believer. You say, what does that mean? That means because of what Jesus did on the cross, that all of us have access to the Lord. Think about that. Access to the Lord. You see, you don't have to have Pastor Terry and Pastor Wayne, Pastor Bobby Graham to come to us and us make access to God for you. No, you don't have to have a priest. The Catholics that are watching me out there, you don't have to confess your sins to an earthly priest. You can if you want to, but it doesn't do any good. Why do that when you can confess your sins to a holy God? You can confess your sins to God because now, because of the cross and because of Good Friday, every single person can have access to God himself. Man, I'm going to tell you, I'm having a hard time sitting here. I mean, this makes me want to shout today to know that all of us can. That's why the Bible says that whosoever calls upon the Lord shall be saved. I mean, don't you listen to the hyper-Calvinists? They're out there. They're telling you that when Jesus died on the cross on that Good Friday, that he just died for a few people, just a select few. Oh, no. The Bible says it. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. And the Bible says that God created the world, and he also created everything in the world, which means you. You say, man, that's pretty amazing. So I want you to understand something. It was not the soldiers that killed Jesus. Oh, yeah, they drove the nails through him. They took that cross and they placed it in the ground and they lifted up that cross. But I'm going to tell you something. They didn't kill Jesus. He gave himself for us. The Bible says that, in fact, what the Bible says in theological terms is he became the Lamb of God. Now, I don't have a lot of time to explain this, but I want to remind you of something. All the way back to Genesis, there's always had to be a sacrifice for sin. Adam and Eve, when they sinned, the Bible says they realized they were naked, but more than that, they literally became afraid of God. You know why? Because they realized they had gone against God. They realized they'd sinned against God, and they were afraid. Now, let me tell you something. If you're not a Christian today, you ought to be afraid of God. excuse me, I know that there's a lot of Satanists out there. Satanism is on the go, like I've never seen before. People brag about being a Satanist like never before. Well, let me tell you something. If you're a Satanist out there and you're watching me today, I'm telling you, I'm warning you that you ought to be in fear of who God is. One person said to me this week, his name's Steve, he said, these poor Satanists don't realize they're going to end up in hell someday. And man, what a tragedy it's going to be. But I'm going to tell you something. Not only are the Satanists going to end up in hell, those of us that have not taken advantage of salvation are going to end up in hell. You see, just because Jesus invites everyone to be saved, you have to receive the gift of salvation. Yeah, you say, well, I thought Jesus died on the cross for everyone. He did, but Jesus never forces himself upon anyone. Did you hear what I said? Jesus never forces himself upon anyone. That's why to go to heaven, the Bible says, to many as them as received him. That means they took him. That means they said, I know I can't save myself, and I know that Jesus did something for me on the cross that I can't do for myself. Man, I tell you, I just love this. I could just teach all day on this subject, what I'm talking about right now. It is so important that we understand this. You say, okay, Pastor Terry, you said that the Bible calls Jesus the Lamb of God. Well, the reason that's important is we go back to the book of Genesis, and we find that when Adam and Eve sinned, that the animals were killed. And I was asking Pastor Pat about that today. He said that was the first blood sacrifice. And by the way, they took the skin of the animals, and that's the clothes that Adam and Eve wore. And then later on, we see that from that point on, that God required blood for the remission of sin. Now, don't miss this. All the way through the Old Covenant, and that's what the Old Testament means. It means Old Covenant. And the New Testament means New Covenant. Even in the Old Covenant, there always required a blood sacrifice. And that's what Passover was all about. And that's why the Jewish laws and the Jewish teachings are important to us. Let me just say this real quickly. I know I want to thank you for watching. I know our time is of the essence. But I'm going to tell you something. All of the Jewish feast and all of the Jewish customs were important. In fact, I would say this. It is really hard to understand the fullness of Christianity without understanding the Jewish law and understanding why the Jews did what they did. But they were required to bring a blood sacrifice. Blood was required. And we know that the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies, and we know that atonement was made in the Old Testament, and once a year, once every year, that the people would have to bring the best animal they had to be sacrificed. Why? Because of sin. Sin has to be dealt with. God is a holy God, and God cannot tolerate sin. So here's what was happening. While Jesus was suffering on the cross, he was taking care of the sin problem. Man, think about that. Jesus was taking care of our sin problem. Remember what I said a while ago? Jesus, on Good Friday, those many years ago when he was dying on that cross, it's Good Friday is because he was becoming our sacrifice. Now, in the Old Testament, you had to use an animal, the blood of the animal. When you get into the New Covenant in the book of Hebrews, it tells us that we no longer have to offer the blood of animals. Why? Because Jesus became the Lamb of God. And what God said is, I will accept the blood of my son. And by the way, that's the only blood that he accepts now. He won't accept the blood of animals. You can go out and kill all the animals you want to kill. By the way, that's what Satanists do. You ever wonder why Satanists kill animals? And they really emphasize blood a lot. Sometimes in the satanic rituals, they will drink blood. They'll put blood in a cup, and sometimes, unfortunately, even be involved in human sacrifice. I happen to know that human sacrifice from Satanists has occurred in Corpus Christi, Texas. I worked in law enforcement here for almost 10 years. I was a lieutenant with the Nueces County Sheriff's Office, and I worked some cases that where there was satanic rituals involved, and there was murder involved, and there was human sacrifice involved. And so that's what Satan does, because Satan knew that God required blood. He required a blood sacrifice. And so today, the Satanists are trying to copy that. And so They drink blood or they shed blood. They kill animals. But I want to tell you something. It's all in vain. It's all in vain. First of all, Satan is a liar. Satan will never be your savior. And it's also a lie because Satan and all the Satanists are going to end up in hell one of these days. I'm going to tell you, Satanists out there, you better love Satan. You better want to be with Satan. You better love those demons that you say you love and that you cling to and you plead for. Because I'm going to tell you one of these days, you're going to be in hell with all of them. And that's going to be a tragedy. And so it doesn't matter today. There's no longer a need for any kind of blood sacrifice. The Christians don't have to do sacrifices anymore. Why? Because Jesus said it on the cross here. Look again when he says here in verse 28, and knowing that all things were accomplished in verse 28. That's exactly what that means. When he said, Telestai, it is finished. Those last words on the cross, it meant this. It meant that sin was a terrible thing. Sin separated us from God. Your sin and my sin is a terrible thing. You say, why is it terrible? Because it kept us away from God. We could have never gone to heaven without Jesus Christ. And by the way, the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ is the only blood, the only remission of sins can come through Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man can come to the Father except through me. That's in John chapter 14, verse 6. You just go back a few chapters and you find that. John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, I'm the only way to go to heaven. Being religious won't let you go to heaven. Being a good person won't let you go to heaven. It just won't do it. Being nice won't do it. The only way that anybody gets to go to heaven is by accepting what Jesus did on the cross at Good Friday. And the reason is our sin separated us from God. So here's what happened. When Jesus became the Lamb of God, when Jesus died on that cross, when he says here, Telestai, it is finished, I want you to know that opened the door for us to be able to go to heaven. People oftentimes say, ma'am, the cross, is the cross a big deal? You better believe it's a big deal. And by the way, all hell knows it's a big deal. All the demons know the cross was a big deal. Oh, I'm sure they thought, man, we got Jesus. Can you imagine? I bet you all the demons were hissing and happy, and they were all together saying, yeah, Jesus is on the cross. We got him on the cross. Well, I'm going to tell you, they may have celebrated, but if they did, that celebration didn't last very long. And I'm going to tell you something. We too can celebrate the cross. You say, man, how can we celebrate? Why can we celebrate Good Friday? Because of the good that comes out of the cross, the good that comes out of the cross. I want you to think about this real quickly. I want you to go back in verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished, telestai. And I mean, that is such a Greek word. It means that it's accomplished. It's everything is done. And when Jesus cried out, it's finished, it meant that we would have access to God. So if you've never accepted Jesus to go to heaven, all you have to do is say, Jesus, I know I can't save myself. And the good news, we don't have to. Salvation is by grace, for by grace have you been saved. Ephesians chapter 2. For by grace have you been saved. By faith. By God's grace. He's done all of it. Every once in a while, someone will say to me, well, you're saying, preacher, I don't have to do anything to go to heaven. I don't have to do anything to be saved. Exactly, because of what happened at Good Friday. You do have to do one thing. You have to receive him. That's what you have to do. You see, you have a choice. You can choose heaven or you can choose hell. To go to heaven, all you have to do is just pray a prayer. All you have to do is say, Jesus, I know I can't save myself. Jesus, come into my heart. I hope you'll do that right now. Before we finish this message, I mean before you go to bed tonight, I mean if you've not nailed it down, you need it down, simply say, Jesus, come into my life and save me. And by the way, if you prayed that prayer with one of our pastors, as we've been hearing these messages, and maybe it's the first time you've heard this before, and you say, preacher, I'm doing it right now. I'm simply saying, Jesus, come into my life. Jesus, I want to be saved. We want to hear from you. We want to know when you got saved. And by the way, I encourage you to write it down. Get a copy of your Bible and put in your Bible. This day I prayed with Pastor Terry Fox. This day I realized that Jesus died on the cross for my sins, and I can go to heaven if I accept what he did for me. I'm going to take Jesus as my sacrifice. And we want you to chat that. Many of you online ought to be chatting that right now. I ask you this question. When were you saved? I was 12 years old when I was saved, and it was an amazing experience in my life. And, oh, I'm glad I'm saved. I've never regretted one day of it. And you won't either. All you have to do is call upon the Lord, and it starts a real journey in your life. I want you to think as we get ready to conclude, two things. What did the cross produce? You know, why is it a Good Friday? First of all, it produced redemption, and I've already said that. The word redemption means to be saved. It means to be set free. It means to be brought out of bondage. Jesus has redeemed us. Redemption comes from the cross. But the second thing is this. The second thing is this, and I don't want you to miss this. This is very, very important. Not only did the cross produce redemption, but I love this, it produced reconciliation. Redemption number one, reconciliation number two. And you say reconciliation, you know that's a word. It's really an accounting term. It means to make things right. It means to balance the sheet. It means because of Good Friday, because he became our blood sacrifice, because he fulfilled the mission his Father sent him on, we are now reconciled with God. I'm going to tell you that'll make you happy today. You know what it means? It means that we're friends with God. It means we're on friendly terms with the Lord. Oh, I'm so glad Jesus is my Savior. I love him more every day. I got to be honest with you. I just love him. I can't imagine, especially with this pandemic going on. And by the way, when this crisis is over with, there'll be another one. We're in the last days. There's going to be more and more pandemics. You wait and see. The Bible predicts it. You say, how do you know? The Bible predicts it. There's going to be a lot of catastrophes that are going to come to the world, but also storms in our own life. I can't imagine having to go through a pandemic, having to go through some crisis, and not be in love with Jesus, and not to know that I have received that Jesus who died on the cross for me, and I've accepted him as my Lord and Savior. I want to just thank you again for studying with us. I encourage you during this Holy Week, as we've been celebrating, I encourage you to study the Word of God. Study these verses. They are power-packed. I tell you, I just love my Bible. And I've been pastoring now for 40-plus years, almost 42 years, and I've been preaching this book. And I want to tell you, I love this Bible more than I've ever loved it. It's more real to me than it's ever been. You say, man, after all these years, and I'm still learning from it. That's what's amazing about the Bible. The more that you study it, the more you meditate on it, the more scripture you memorize, the more power comes into your life through the study of God's holy word. I again want you to know we love you. We're praying for you. I can't wait to see everybody soon in Kansas, Arkansas, and Texas. I want you to celebrate Good Friday. I want you to tune in. Remember, every evening while this crisis is going on, we're going to be bringing a message to you from one of our pastors, a message, and it'll be a life-changing message every night at 7 o'clock. Be sure and share that. And again, I mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast, be sure and give financially. Don't forget about your tithes and offerings. The church's bills are going on, the ministry's going on, and we need you to be faithful. SummitChurchTexas.com, SummitChurchTexas.com/give. It's easy to do. Give online or mail in a check. If you're in Corpus Christi, you can bring it by and put it in the mailbox. We have a locked mailbox right there by the front doors. You'll see where the mailbox is. I love you all, and thank you for studying God's Word, and I can't wait till we get back together again. God bless you.